what do you make of the revelations by the former PM today?
Well, his personal medical history is his story. I think he was a pretty average Prime Minister. But on this point, I would say I respect him coming out and talking about it, because at the very least, if he says, listen, I needed help, I was taking medication, what that might do is it might lead to other people seeking help. And if pharmaceuticals are one way that a medico says this is how you deal with, well, there's no shame in that. So, no, I think my summary is, as a Prime Minister, I think he wasn't very good, but that's a matter of record, I've said that. But on this matter, it's his history, and if he's come forward and chosen to share it with us, I hope that other people realise that seeking support when you're doing it tough, be it depressed or stressed or anxious or you can't get out of bed in the morning, then that's probably a good thing. Because if a Prime Minister says they have that problem, then maybe it's okay for other people to admit they've got that problem too.
Indeed, there's no shame in it at all. And we've had the Chair of Mental Health Australia, Matt Berryman. He's pulled the pin in that role today. He says he's not getting a decent hearing. He said he had a good relationship with Mark Butler, but couldn't get a hearing with Anthony Albanese. And the way that Mr. Berryman puts it, he thinks that Mr. Albanese's missed the Port Arthur moment, where John Howard stood up in the wake of the Bondi attack. Mr. Albanese needed to stand up on mental health. What's your read on that?
Well, that's one person's opinion. I don't share it. In terms of the shocking, shocking, terrible violence at Bondi Westfield, our Prime Minister was leading from the front, so I don't think it's right to criticise him for that. In terms of mental health, the same person says he likes our Health Minister, so I guess that's positive. I can't speak about other parts of the government and their portfolios, but I know in my own area of the NDIS, yeah, we want more to be done, absolutely. But there is probably some green shoots there of something better than the last 10 years. 10 years ago, the NDIS didn't exist. Now it certainly does. And one group who benefit from the NDIS are the 60,000-plus people with severe mental health challenges who receive NDIS support with some of their aspects of living and being able to have a more fulfilling life. So, yeah, that's some days it feels like two steps forward, one step back. Other days, one step forward, two steps back. But, you know, well, this is a government who's wants to make sure that Australians have fulfilling lives, and we are making investments. But in my area, sure, we've got more work to do, but I can't comment about this fellow, and I don't think his attack on the Prime Minister, I don't know if it changes anything for mental health. It's just him getting something off his chest, but I think the Prime Minister's doing a good job.
On the NDIS, we saw, and I haven't spoken to you since, this intervention by Gary Banks, former head of the Productivity Commission. He said that when it was put together and suggested, that it was overestimated the return to the economy and underestimated the risk of overservicing. What did you think of his intervention? Was there anything to learn from it?
Not a lot. He's entitled to his opinion, but he's basically saying he thinks he made a mistake. I guess that's up to him. It's free country. Everyone's got an opinion. No, I think the benefit to the economy is profound. The reality is that there are hundreds of thousands of people whose lives are being changed for the better by the NDIS. We see in a range of metrics from greater participation, less social isolation, care is able to do more work, and now there's 400,000 people working in the sector, that it is, it's now an investment. It's no longer viewed just as charity. Now, there are plenty of improvements we can make to the scheme, though. The sort of ironic thing in this job, occasionally you've got to develop a little bit of a sense of humour, is that this bloke's complaining that there's wasteful spending in the scheme, but that's because we've just left it all to the market. What happened is a payment scheme was established, then Labor went out of power, but not enough was done to create proper rules in the market, and now we're fixing up some of those problems. So I wouldn't be as pessimistic as Mr. Banks, and he's always happy to come and have a meeting with me. I mean, he's an intelligent fellow, but on this one, I think the idea of giving up on the NDIS is just flat earth. We're not going back to what existed beforehand. We are committed to improving the scheme, and all constructive suggestions are welcomed and valued.
Minister Bill Shorten, thanks. Talk to you soon.
Indeed, Kieran. Have a nice day.